Chris Zielicki is with me here from OneLNG. Chris, good afternoon. Nice to see you.
Good to see you.
OneLNG, a partnership here between Golar and Schlumberger.
Correct.
Talk to me about the initial vision when bringing these two together.
It was over a year ago when we were actually looking at this new concept called FLNG, floating liquefaction. Nothing particularly new, apart from the fact that you're putting an awful lot of equipment into a very small space on a ship. The interesting thing was that people were not that interested in ships. So what we decided is we were going to actually have a concept. We weren't selling a ship. We weren't selling or leasing a ship. We were going to actually solve a problem, and the problem is stranded gas. Places which you wouldn't develop ever could be actually developed using stranded gas technology, including the FLNG. The next question is, great, Golar builds fantastic vessels, which is where the FLNG comes from, but knows very little about the upstream. Who knows about the upstream? Well, it could be a major, but to be fair, they're not going to work that closely together in the sense that, you know, the major and a tiny, small shipping company. So then we went to Schlumberger, which was the natural choice. So we could actually develop the technology, we could actually develop the upstream, we could do subsea technology, we could develop platforms, and you are basically a one-stop shop for gas developments.
A one-stop shop, and I suppose the beautiful thing here is that it's not suitable for one market in particular. It can be used anywhere.
It can be used anywhere, anywhere in the world. There are some markets which obviously are naturals, like Africa, but the truth is you can park this ship anywhere. You have access to even pipeline gas, like the States.
So relatively speaking, quite cost-effective?
It's very low cost. This is the huge difference between an onshore. Most onshore plants, even the more sophisticated ones in the States, will cost an average of about $800 per ton for capacity. This is coming in at around $500 per ton capacity, so it's cheaper. And if you look at some of the developments, and I won't name which ones, but they can go up to $2,000 per ton capacity. So this is a fraction of some of the sort of costs. It's cheap. You don't have to basically worry about 4,000 people, which it could take to build a large plant. In some cases, you build towns, hospitals, roads, infrastructure to even keep that number of people going. Here, you use a shipyard, which has all the staff there, and you ship it in.
And I'd imagine a lot of interest?
There's a lot of interest. Our first ship is now actually being commissioned as we speak. And obviously there are the cynics who say, well, is this going to work? But a great deal of interest. Everyone is watching.
You say the cynics are questioning, is this going to work? What aspects are they questioning?
I won't mention one very, very well-known leader of a large company called this the floating bomb. The truth is, it's a question of whether you can actually maintain and run something like this in a very tight space. Maintenance, running. The truth is, the technology is 30 years old. It's Preco technology. It's old. It's proved. The tanks, the ships are, you know, they are 20, 30 years old. They've been running. So that works. Can you actually do all this work in a small space effectively without sort of, you know, things going wrong? So that's the big question. And we'll know as we sort of in the coming months that that's going to become very clear.
Indeed. Looking at the next couple of years, there's going to be a lot of gas coming on. Is there the demand there? Is that keeping up?
No. The trouble is supply and demand is out of sync at the moment. Years ago, there was this huge rush to build LNG terminals. So what you've got is it's a cocktail of possibly between 60 and 70 million tons coming in from the States already in the pipeline. You have LNG coming in from the Arctic, the huge developments in Russia. You have Qatar, even debottlenecking. Let's not talk about some massive development. Qatar, possibly coming in with 10, 20 million tonnes just debottlenecking. You have Australia still coming in with their developments. And all of this creates a huge, basically, amount of gas which comes onto the market. Now, demand is growing, and it's growing 8%, 10%. We can argue about where it is. But the trouble is that the supply is actually growing much faster than demand. So you have a few, you'll have about maybe 5 years where the two are out of sync, and then the two come together. Probably 2023, 2024.
So in the meantime, how does that affect your way, affect the way you do business?
You basically have to be careful about developing things. They have to be cheap. The development has to be cheap. You have to live in a world where you're talking about $4.5, $5 per BTU. If you can't develop and basically export gas in that sort of price range, you shouldn't be developing it at the moment. So you have to be cheap. At the same time, we are actually doing taking one further step down the chain, where we're actually getting involved in power stations, which actually take the LNG and use the LNG. So you're creating a short. Somebody once said, there is no gas market. You know, you have to create it. And that's true to some degree. So again, and this is where the gas industry has to work very hard. It has to be creative. It has to create shorts, which then can be filled. Now, the question is, this will work very well in small developments, 2.5 million tons developments. Now, we're talking about the world market is, 300 million tons. So 2.5 million tons is not bad. If you're doing 5 million tons, 10 million tons, the really big, old-fashioned, massive developments, to push that much LNG into the market in 1 year actually causes a major problem. So you have to be careful.
So to some extent, do you reckon gas is acting like a bridge in this energy transformation which we're going through, or due to go through?
Yeah, and the gas is basically there to is going to be used in two particular markets. Firstly, power. Now, power is very, very interesting because actually gas and, for example, renewables could work very closely together. So if you could actually put gas and renewables together, and you can do it on a cocktail, 50-50, 60-40, depends how you want to play it, you actually have a sustainable amount of power generation, which is clean, which is actually uses a fraction of the CO2 which coal would be using. And at the same time, you have the renewables coming together. So that's certainly the greener and quite cheap way of generating electricity. Much cheaper than Hinkley Point. It'll come in at half the price, maybe even a third of the price of Hinkley. On the other side, LNG will also be used in transportation. It's starting to be used in ships. It can be used in trucks. Cars, no. That's going too far. But trains, trucks, and ships could be using LNG very effectively. So that's the transformation where you're starting to create more and more markets in power and transportation.
So the key over the next couple of years at least, being cost-effective, being cheap, and you reckon if LNG is your key ingredient here?
It's a key ingredient. It's one of the ingredients. I'm not saying that you don't want to build huge, massive developments, but the truth is the market is changing, and these smaller developments are certainly the way the next few years will work. The other interesting thing which we found was our original concept was to go to fields where you just couldn't do it any other way, you know. So you stick the ship over the seabed, you have subsea, you know, tubes going up, end of story. You know, so risers, that was it. And you couldn't do it any other way. And we thought, that's our niche. The interesting thing that's happened in the last years, we've discovered quite a lot of majors are now coming to us and saying, we've got a big development and we don't want to do it in a massive 10 million, 15 million ton development. We're going to do it piecemeal. We're going to do it in 2-3 million ton developments. And slotting these vessels in is an ideal way to do that because you can do it as slowly as quickly and you can test the market. So if the market is not moving in the way, you know, sort of you believe is sort of the prices are not going sort of at the speed or going up at the speed at which you want it, you stop. You don't need to, you know, and you can wait for a few years.
You're managing risk as well.
You're managing risk, exactly.
Chris, it's been fascinating to talk to you. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.